to a person to the Supreme Court order, the Supreme Court had ordered in Murli Bhil Project was that you do a cumulative impact study with special focus on the aquatic biodiversity. So the aquatic biodiversity part was given to the WRI and the rest of the cumulative impact study was given to IIT Roorkee.
We are already fighting the IIT Roorkee in the National Green Tribunal and other places. But then WII's limited role was to look at the focus, not I would not say limited role, but the focus was to look at the aquatic biodiversity. In the Supreme Court, it was aquatic. When it has come, they have looked at, in some cases, they have looked at terrestrial. That is also, I will explain a little dicey. Now, the basic problem is that WII has relied on IWMI. Wildlife Institute has basically relied on the International Water Management Institute methodology. Now, the IWMI, the International Water Management Institute, has done a study of the various basins of India and developed certain benchmark environment flow recommendations. But the IWMI's report, which gives these recommendations, themselves said, the IWMI report itself says there are certain shortcomings of this their recommendation, which I want to point out to you. First thing they say is that IWMI has not considered the terrestrial ecosystems. I'm talking about IWMI, there are two reports. One is 107, which is about the environmental flow. Another is 114, which is about the categorization in the environment management class. But this is regarding 107, which is regarding environmental flows. So what they are saying is that in the river, there are two types of biodiversity. One is the biodiversity in the water and one is on the land. And they have calculated these e-flows only for the aquatic biodiversity and not for whatever happens on the land. So if you consider the land, then also there will be some more in requirement of water and the environmental flow will go up. Second, they say that the environment flow has to be determined as per the agreed objective of how you want the river to be. So these are the shortcomings, not shortcomings, that word is actually incorrect. These are the factors which IWMI itself recognizes that have not been undertaken in determining the environmental flow. Why I'm going into this is because IWMI, what it has done is what WII has done, it has first categorized Ganga as Environment Management Class C and then said that IWMI has said that C category river requires 28% environmental flow. And therefore, that is the beginning point of WII exercise. Am I with you or am I going out? 20 MAR, mean angle runoff, MAR. Am I with you or am I not clear? Should I go more detail? Okay. Now, the IWMI recommendation of 28%, the question is whether that is adequate or not. Because WII has relied on that, they said that because IWMI says 28%, therefore we start with 28%, then they manipulate whether they will go up or down or whatever. But the starting point is 28% as recommended by IWMI. But what does IWMI say when it says 28%? First, it says that it has not taken count of the terrestrial ecosystems. Second, they say that we have not considered the agreed objective of a certain state of river. A Ganga river may be polluted today. There is a certain environmental flow that is recommended today. But if you want to remove pollution, then you may need more water. So there has to be a social consensus, some decision that what you want the river to be. And accordingly, you have to modify the environmental flows. So IWMI says that we have not considered this. This is very important because the NGRBA and the government of India is saying clearly that we want to restore River Ganga, conserve River Ganga. I think the word restore was used by Prime Minister in his recent NGRBA speech where he says that we want to upgrade it. So this has not been accounted. If you want, maybe Ganga is in category C today, but maybe tomorrow we want it to become category B or category A. So that would require more environmental flows, but that is not considered. Then the trend of change. If the river as it is exists today is declining. It is becoming more polluted, more bad in every in whatever sense. Then you have to add more water to it. That has not been considered. Then the IWMI itself says that look, we have used this shifting flow duration curve. Please don't ask me what how this works. I don't know. But what they say is that we have used this shifting FDC method and they have arrived at 28.9% river inflows for Ganga at category C. At category C. But IWMI itself says that the desktop reserve model gives 39.7 and they themselves say that desktop reserve model is a better model. They could not do it. But then when WIA is using that data, then it was incumbent on WIA to say that alright, we let us look at desktop reserve model. They have not done that. And then the socio-economic importance. Ultimately, why are we talking about Ganga is because of its socio-economic impact for any river. Now what WIA said, that this is at par, but we are looking at Uttarakhand. And therefore, what they said is that we do not need 28.9. It is enough to you give only 14.5 or 21.8, which is 14.5%. So they halved it. They said we need only half of this. Now, why did they say that? They said because, number one, we have looked only at the aquatic biodiversity. What they are saying is for the fish, for the fish survival, this is the amount of water that is required, therefore we reduce it. So what they do, first IWMI gives a figure of 28.9% based upon the terrestrial, aquatic, socio-economic and all other factors. They cut off all other factors, they remove all other factors and say that only for aquatic, this is sufficient. In upper reaches, where there are not many fish, they say 14.5% is sufficient. For lower reaches, it is 21.8. I had a discussion this morning with WIA and asked them that how can you reduce it. My argument was that the figure, you see what they have written in the report is that the biodiversity between Rishikesh and Farakka is much higher than the biodiversity above Rishikesh. And because of the lower biodiversity, you do not need so much water. This is the argument. So my argument was that the distance between Rishikesh to Farakka is about 1300 kilometers. And if it is 1300 kilometers with three clearly different climatic or what you call geomorphological zones, then the biodiversity will definitely be higher. You are taking a figure of biodiversity for a 1300 kilometer stretch and applying it to 300 kilometers, which is not there. If at all you wanted to compare biodiversity, you should have looked at a 300 kilometer stretch in the Ganga as per IWMI and then looked at whether it will have the same biodiversity value upstream or not. Instead of doing that, they have simply said that because in this upper stretch of the Ganga, the biodiversity is less than what is between Rishikesh and Farakka and therefore we do not need so much water, so we will reduce it. The basic difficulty is that you have the IWII has not honestly or honestly is a strong word, not adequately taken care of the how this 28.9 was arrived, and they have then reduced it from 28 to 14 by ignoring the social factors and ignoring the terrestrial biodiversity. They say clearly that this is only for aquatic biodiversity. So, but the problem is that the ministry is not considering this. For the ministry, this is environmental flow period. No social factor, whether this environmental flow is only for aquatic or it is for other factors, that has not been considered by the ministry. So the ministry, IWMI considers social, terrestrial and aquatic biodiversity. WII removes the terrestrial and social, reduces it to 14.5, and ministry says that 14.5 is what we need and we don't have to look beyond. So that is the basic difficulty, is that they have ignored the social and other aspects. Effectively, the other contradiction is that WII, they have a scoring system in which they have scored
that Ganga is category 3 environment management class. Now, but when you take 14.5, that is the environmental flow of any category. So there is an internal contradiction. On the one hand, WII is saying that the environmental management class is C, but then the environmental flows that it is recommending are for environment class E. And why they are saying? Because simply because it is enough for the aquatic biodiversity, therefore they justify it. These are the other factors that have ignored, that if there are certain endangered species, how much habitats do you require for their recovery? For example, in this stretch, there are two, I don't know what exactly is the term, one is the chief pheasant, which is a, what they call endemic.
Endangered species.
Endangered, they also be different there. No. There is a particular trend. The chief pheasant, they are saying, it is of an evolutionary line which is becoming extinct. It is the only bird, not endemic, there is this particular word, doesn't matter. But what they are saying is that there is a particular line of evolution which is becoming extinct, and this is the sole remaining animal species of that line. And therefore, it is more important to conserve it. Otter, then that is chief pheasant, then there is otter, smooth coated otter that is known in this area. They said that it has been, we have seen some marks, but we have not sighted it, therefore, we will ignore it. Then, habitats for recovery, upgrading the river, socio-economic, cultural importance, and riparian and terrestrial life, all these factors have been ignored. This is a suggestion that I had given to Nitin also, and I have been saying repeatedly. And I had actually met Mr. Mathur at WII before they did this study. And I had suggested to them that instead, you see, the present model is that you make a barrage across the river. And if you release even 100% water from the barrage, still there will be huge environmental impacts. Is this clear? No. See, today we are making a barrage across the riverbed and we are stopping all the water. So if, let us say, X amount of water is coming and we release the same amount, some of you may have seen the Bijnor barrage on the way between Delhi and Bijnor. Now that is the situation where in 8 months of the year, the canal is not working, canal is only used for the kharif season, but the barrage is there and whatever amount of water is coming, that is the amount of water that has been released. But still there is a huge environmental impact because, as Himanshu said, the sediments are getting trapped, the fishes cannot migrate, and the fishing is affected, and so many other things. So what I suggested to them, and I would like to suggest this for the consideration of this house also, that what we need is what I am calling partial obstruction or riverbed connecting. We don't have a whiteboard. Okay. Instead of making a barrage across the entire river, what we should do is, let us say we want to release 50% environmental and 50% water we want to use for hydrogen power generation. So let us put an obstruction in the middle and remove 50% of the water, but let 50% of the water continue to flow uninterrupted, so that the sediment flow and the fish migration and continues uninterrupted on the remaining environmental flow. Now, I have given this suggestion to WII. So why don't you look at it? They said this is a very good suggestion, we should look at it, but it is not in the TOR. So the basic problem is not only environmental flow, it is how you release the environmental flow. To my mind, that is more important. For example, in Vishnugarh, people floating. What happened was that the project was approved for 444 megawatt, and the initial environmental flow was 3 cubics. But then after IIT Roorkee report, they increased it to 14 cubics. So when they increased it to 14 cubics, the THDC, they decided to install a small turbine at the base of the dam to use the environmental flow. What it means is that 14 cubics of water will not be released from the dam directly into the river. It will go through another small turbine of 4 megawatt or whatever, generate electricity and then they release. Now the point is that defeats the whole purpose of environmental flow, because when you are putting that 14 cubics of water into another turbine, you are going to remove the sediment, you are going to remove the organic debris, you are not going to allow the fish to migrate. So the basic purpose of environmental flow, to the extent it helps in jumping the barrier, is already negated. So my point is that when we discuss environmental flow, we should also discuss manner of release of environmental flow. And what it means is that whatever is the amount of environmental flow, that should flow uninterrupted into the river. Now the counter argument from the side of the government and the project proponents is, main argument is that when they make a barrage on the river, they can use the reservoir to store the water for peaking requirement. In this case, if you allow the river bed connectivity, part of the river is flowing freely, then they cannot make a reservoir on the river bed. So they will have to make a reservoir outside the bed, which would increase their cost. And the second, I think more important, is that they lose control over water. What Himanshu has been saying, that even if you specify X amount of water as environmental flow, actually it is not released. And what they do, the dam companies will do, is they will not release it, because the releasing is under their control. But in a partial obstruction, they lose control because they cannot hold that water. And therefore, I think we need to stress in our representations that it is not only a question of how much water you release, but how you release. I think that is very important. See, the Ramsar Convention says, incorporate long-term social benefit and cost consideration into the process from the very initial stages of project preparation. What does WII say? Hydropower share in mix of power is far below the desired level. Without doing any cost benefit, I spoke to them this morning. I asked them, how do you say this? On what basis are you saying this? Hey, it is obvious. I said, no, it is not obvious, because you have not done any cost benefit analysis. How much is the cost of this electricity generation? How much is the benefit? What are the environmental impacts? And what is the monetary value of those environmental impacts? Until you make that consideration, you cannot decide how much water to release. The another very interesting part of the WII report is, what they did was, they have quoted the WCD, World Commission of Dams, and they have given a definition of what is a benign dam. Today they disowned it in my discussion, but in the report they said that we have only quoted it, we don't mean it. But that aside, the important point is that repeatedly I come across discussion that let us make small dams, gadere pe bana do, chote nadi, chote chote bahut sare dam bana do, bade dam nahi banne chahiye, run of river, bade dam mat banao, chote dam banao. There is somehow a perception that a small dam is better than a big dam. Now, I think that is a very big fallacy. See, essentially the question is that if a small dam has small benefit, then the small costs have to be compared to the small benefit. Let's look at it this way. A big dam may provide you 100 units of benefit and has an environmental cost of, let's say, 80. So the environmental cost is less and the benefits are more, you will do it. A small dam may have an environmental cost of 5 units and benefits of 4. It may be less. So I again ask them, how have you said that this, see what they have done in deciding which projects to clear. What they did was, they looked at the length of the river affected, how much is the submergence and how is the area of forest land. And based upon that, they said that if the project is having a small impact, then we will clear it. But this is, I think, basically a false approach. Small impact, you may have a small project which is affecting only 4 kilometers of the river. You may have less submergence, you may have less forest impact. But the benefits may be very small. So would you accept the small cost for a very small benefit? Ultimately, the benefit should be more than the cost. And there is no calculation. Again, when I ask them, that this is not in our TOR, we do. So without doing the TOR, without doing the cost-benefit analysis, there is a bias in favor of small projects. And because I find this being said by a large number of people from the environmental side also, I request you all also to be careful in suggesting small projects because they are small. The impact of a small project on a galera can be more devastating than a bigger impact compared to the benefit. So we have to look at the cost-benefit analysis before you go into this. Determining the length of the river affected. There are two projects where I live. One is Kotlibend. This is Kotlibend, and another is Srinagar. Now both projects have similar capacity. Both are 320-330 megawatt. Both have a reservoir of about 25 to 30 kilometers. The Srinagar project also has a canal or tailway, what you call it, from the dam they will ship. Is that the tailway?
It's
a tunnel. No, it's not tunnel. It's an open canal. It's an open canal which will go for 4 kilometers. So what they did is, in working out the score for Srinagar, they took only the figure of the canal and ignored the 30 kilometer of Srinagar. Simply ignored it. I mean, a project which is affecting the river for 35 kilometers, they said it is affecting only 5 kilometers because they took only the canal and ignored the rest. So, but this they said that, okay, this is a mistake, we will, we cannot rectify it, but you can write to the ministry, and if the ministry says, then we will think about it. I think that is the beginning of the process. And that should include the aquatic, terrestrial, riparian, and also the social aspects of the river. The tragedy of this study is that it has ignored the social and riparian and terrestrial, and based on aquatic only they have given e-flows, but the ministry is taking them as a comprehensive e-flow suggestion, and they are not taking into account that this has been arrived at without looking at these. Second is that the categorization of river into class C river and whether it's a target river. You see, if we have made the Ganga River Basin Authority and declared Ganga as a national river, then obviously we don't want necessarily it to remain in C category. So if it has to be improved in categorization, then that is comprehensive. And thirdly, the manner of release of water has not been examined. How you release the water and what is the impact even if you release the X amount of water, this has not been incorporated. And fourth, the whole question of small dams, that is not there. So, I think that is basically what I wanted to say. These are the basic weaknesses I find in the WII report. And now I will just comment on two or three points made earlier and then I will close. First of all, I think we should not give up hope at all. I think it is very important. I can assure you from my heart that when I have given the representation to the Central Empowered Committee regarding the forest clearance of Kotlibend, I had no idea that it will have this impact. But the Central Empowered Committee asked for a cumulative impact assessment, and that has led to so many of these impacts. So, at the same time, I made many other representations. I made to the Forest Advisory Committee, to the we filed the case in the Environment Tribunal, and so on and so forth. They did not have such impact. So, what I am saying is that even if the ministry is not positive towards us, whatever small venues we have to push our case, I think where and how and when they will have a cascading effect, we do not know, and some of them can be very beneficial. So that is one. Second point was made from our friend about Uttarakhand's power protection. See, there are two, three things. First of all, Uttarakhand's demand is about 2000 megawatt. Now, what we are doing now is not producing power for meeting Uttarakhand's demand. What Uttarakhand is doing is trying to produce 10,000 megawatt, 20,000 megawatt, so that the 12% free power that we get is enough to meet the demand. Which means that the Uttarakhand will bear 88% of the environmental cost for supplying power to Haryana, Delhi or XYZ. So you bear the 100% of the environmental cost or 12% of the power. What I am suggesting is, first of all, that if you have, if your need is 2000 megawatt, please do not generate power more than 2000 megawatt. Let the rest of it continue. Second point, even if you generate, you should go through partial obstruction. I hope I will have the energy and support from people like you. I want to file a petition in the Supreme Court saying that the Vishnu Prayag project should be redesigned into a partial obstruction. I am not saying that dismantle the project at this point. Maybe we should ask for decommission. But we should say that we wanted to remove the barrage and convert it into a partial obstruction. I would suggest that Mulla Periyar or other things, this is actually a cross-cutting issue. It has nothing so specific to Ganga. In every project, this is applicable. We should continue to insist that the environmental flow should go for partial obstruction. So the 2000 megawatt that Uttarakhand needs should be made through this partial obstruction method, not by making barrage. Third thing is that the 2000 megawatt, I have studied the data of Uttarakhand Power Corporation. What I have found is that the electricity supply, they have two divisions in the hills, Ranikhet and Shimla. And there are five or six divisions in the thing which is Haridwar is also. What I found is that electricity supply to the two hill regions has been declining. Actual absolute numbers are going down. Consumption product generation is increasing, but the supply to the hill regions which are producing the power is actually going down because of depopulation. The villages are getting depopulated, industries are not coming up. On the other hand, the demand for industries from industries in the plain is increasing. So Uttarakhand has to take a choice that whether they will continue to destroy the hills and the hill population for supplying power to the plains. Fourth factor is that my own brother had put up a factory in Goa to take care of the tax exemption. The government of India has a tax exemption scheme for a certain period, and the day his tax exemption expired, he closed the factory and brought it to Bangalore. The day, not one day later. My advocate in Lucknow, for, I have some other for a family matter, and he says that already companies in Uttarakhand, which are being supplied, for whom we are generating power. I am answering your point that the demand for 2000 megawatt. This demand of 2000 megawatt is coming for supplying power to the industries and to the air conditioned malls of Delhi. There is no policy to how to regulate the demand for Dehradun, and there is no policy what will happen when these industries, if these industries close up after the tax exemption. Right now the industries are coming because of tax exemption, they want free power or more power, therefore they are here. But after 5 years or 10 years when the tax exemption closes, your rivers will be destroyed, but you will not have the industry also. So I think this whole thing is actually what we need. We need to go beyond cumulative impact assessment. I understand, I have not been able to study it, that there is a third generation of impact assessment, which is now we are calling strategic impact assessment. What the strategic impact assessment does, it looks at what is the overall objective of this whole development process. How much electricity do we need? Can we reduce it? Then after that electricity, how much do we need from hydropower, what are the other? Then they go and see that which hydropower plants are viable in that context. So this, we need to ask now for a strategic impact assessment, not a cumulative impact assessment. So as far as Uttarakhand is concerned, I think Uttarakhand is going in a disastrous method because they are destroying the rivers and they are destroying the huge service sector potential. You look at Switzerland. Switzerland has such a good tourism industry on the bank of its hills and rivers. And you are destroying that tourist potential for supplying electricity to the industries and air conditioning market. So there is a whole political economy angle. To my mind, hydropower is not for development. It is for transfer of resources from poor to the rich. The environmental impacts and the costs are borne by the poor. The electricity is enjoyed by the rich, and therefore there is a whole nexus operating to deprive the poor from their fishes, from their sand, from their biodiversity, from their forests, from their water sources, from their grazing, and transfer those resources to the rich. So we should not get we should not start with the assumption that we need 2000 megawatt and this is the only option. The THDC produced their World Bank appraisal document. in which it was written that they were going to install this. So when we started raising this issue, now World Bank has told us that they have abandoned that. So, I mean, what I mean to say, this goes on, this is a cat and cat.
In fact, EC between the dry and dry patches.
No, they were river is flowing. And in that flowing stage, they are giving that these are the fishes that are formed. Right. Claw, another basic problem which I mentioned this earlier, is that these are out of the 39 proposed that is on the Rappahannock River. And what they did was, they removed the dam because there was a resistance from the fishing, not the commercial fishes, the recreation fishing and canoeing and kayaking. And what they did was, they put a pumping station and they made an artificial reservoir somewhere separate. Whenever the water in the river is more, they pump it and store it in the reservoir. And when the water in the river is less, they release the water back into the reservoir. And the river is now flowing freely. The city of Fredericksburg is getting its water, and this is happening. So that is one example I know. There may be others. I'm sure there will be others, but I know this one example.
Can the same reservoir be used for generating power?
Yes.